Okay, so here we are in 2 Samuel chapter 9 and 10 is what we'll be looking at tonight. The events that have unfolded prior to these chapters will kind of come into play as we look back at some things here in a moment. As you went through 7 and 8, 7 is a huge messianic kind of prophecy going on in chapter 7, and y'all covered that. Then you have, more battles and people being conquered in chapter 8. We'll have more conquering in chapter 10 tonight, as this section kind of highlights David's victories over his enemies. But we have this kind of weird chapter nestled in between chapters 8 and 10. 8 and 10 deal with conquest, and then in the middle we have sort of this Hallmark Channel kind of story. As we look at chapter 9. But also with chapter 9, we begin what some have dubbed the succession document. Basically, chapter 9 of 2 Samuel into 1 Kings chapter 2, where Solomon takes over, we have sort of the end of the reign of David and the events that unfolded in his life. Chapter 11 really highlights some a major event that everybody knows about in the life of David. And so we'll get to some more trials in the life of David towards the end of 2 Samuel. But again, chapter 9 begins this, what's called the succession document in relationship to the reign of David. Let's look at chapter 9. What chapter heading do you guys have on there? Yes, I wanted you guys to read that name. That's why I asked. Okay. Mephibosheth, yes. So, does that sound familiar? Does it ring a bell? That okay. We've talked about this dude before. Okay. So, verse 1 of chapter 9. Then David said, "Is there yet anyone left of the house of Saul that I may show him kindness for Jonathan's sake?" And so, we're going to be looking at what that's about. And so, now there was a servant in the house of Saul whose name was Ziba, and they called him to David and they asked. And then the king said to him, "Are you Ziba?" And he said, "I am your servant," which, I'm on your team, is how you want to respond with that. And so, "I am your servant." And the king said, "Is there not yet anyone of the house of Saul whom I may show the kindness of God?" We're going to park here for a second and just look at what's unfolding here. Turn back to 1 Samuel chapter 20. 1 Samuel chapter 20, let's kind of flash back and get the setting for what's going on here. First Samuel chapter 20, specifically verse 14. So Jonathan and David are speaking here, and they make this kind of covenant. Let's look down. And beginning in verse 9, Jonathan said, "Far be it from you, for if I should indeed learn that evil has been decided by my father," and so they're trying to determine if David needs to flee or if he can stay. He said, "If evil has been decided by my father to come upon you, then I will not. Then would I not tell you about it?" Then David said to Jonathan, "Who will tell me if your father answers you harshly?" Jonathan said to David, "Come, let us go out into the field." And both of them went. But down in verse, I'm way too far back. Let's go back down to verse 13. "If it please my father to do you harm, may the Lord do so to Jonathan and more also, if I do not make it known to you and send you away, that you may go in safety. May the Lord be with you as he has been with my father." Remember, we talked about this, how Jonathan recognizes this transition. Jonathan, the son of Saul, who would have been the king, recognizes the transition that God is with David, that his lineage as far as a king is not going to continue. And this speaks highly of Jonathan in that he could have contested it, which we see there was that was contested early on in David's reign. He could have done that, but he didn't. He knows that God is with David. And he says in verse 14, "If I am still alive, will you not show me the loving kindness of the Lord, that I may not die?" It was customary in some cases, especially if there was hostility, to kill the old regime, to let, you know, just make sure nobody can contest anything so that my reign as a king is safe and secure. I will kill all the old people that, you know, all the former regime, the former kingship, former monarchy. And Jonathan's saying here, please don't kill me that I may not die. And you shall not cut off your loving kindness from my house forever, not even when the Lord cuts off every one of the enemies of David. So he's asking for the house of Jonathan that there still be a relationship there, that there still be, they wouldn't be killed. So this is where we kind of get the basis for this. Now let's fast forward to 2 Samuel chapter 9. 2 Samuel chapter 9. Again, we have, chapter 4, verse 4. We have a mention here, just a blip. We're introduced to Mephibosheth. Now, Jonathan, Saul's son, had a son crippled in his feet, which, by the way, this mention gets mentioned a lot, that he's crippled. Like, they just happen to just throw this in here, even at the end of chapter 9, and he ate at David's table, and he was crippled. They just kept throwing this. They made sure everybody knows that he's crippled. So here he was 5 years old when the report of Saul and Jonathan came from Jezreel. What happened with Saul and Jonathan? They died, right? The report came, and so his nurse took him up and fled. Again, so Saul, who had persecuted David so harshly, right, could have come in, and as far as everybody's concerned, David's going to come in and kill anybody who had anything to do with Saul and just completely wipe Saul, as far as his lineage, off the face of the earth, and then just start clean with a clean slate. And so this lady, who has been taking care of Mephibosheth, what does she do? She gets up and flees. And it happened that in her hurry to flee, in her haste, he fell and became lame, and his name was Mephibosheth. And so, I don't know how he fell, but he fell. And so that, again, we have 1 Samuel chapter 20, show the kindness to my house. We have this brief introduction that there was a survivor of the lineage of Jonathan. And then here this kind of comes to fruition. David, after he's, you know, defeated all his enemies, he's sitting at home in his cedar house that probably smells quite nice. And he is deciding that it's time to do something for Jonathan. I mean, you can imagine. Have you been busy before? Anybody? Have any of you guys been busy? And you finally get a moment to collect your thoughts. You're like, oh, you remember something. It's kind of what we're seeing here with David. Is there anybody left that I can do this for? And remember the relationship that Jonathan had with David. He's going to want to take care of, especially the household of Jonathan. And so Ziba said to the king, there is still a son of Jonathan. Now, thinking about the kindness of God, let's look over in the New Testament for a moment. In Romans chapter chapter 2, verse 4, we're going to read a few verses and kind of talk about this concept as far as the kindness or showing the kindness of the Lord. Romans chapter 2 and verse 4. Or do you think lightly of the riches of his kindness, capital H? So who are we talking about? God, okay. His kindness and tolerance and patience, not knowing that the kindness of God leads you to repentance. And then kind of a similar tone in Romans chapter 11, I believe verse 22. Behold then the kindness and severity of God to those who fell, severity, but to you God's kindness, if you continue in his kindness. Otherwise, you'll be cut off. And then let's come full circle over to Titus chapter 3. Titus chapter 3, verse 4. But when the kindness of God our Savior and his love for mankind appeared, he saved us, verse 5. Not on the basis of deeds which we have done in righteousness, but according to his mercy, and the washing of regeneration, renewing by the Holy Spirit. So when we look at the kindness of God in relationship to the New Testament concept, we see the kindness of God in our salvation. He didn't have to do what he did, but he said he would, and he completed that. And we see that, you know, thinking of the lineage of David and thinking of prophecy. He didn't have to do that, but his kindness is tied to our salvation. Also, somebody want to look over in Micah chapter 6. Micah chapter 6, verse 8. If I can remember which marker I used. Micah's not one you go to very often, right? Some of you are thinking, where is that? All right, Micah chapter 6, verse 8. He has told you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you but to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God? And if you think about the life of David, does that not describe David? To do justice, what is right, to show kindness, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with God. You see that in the life of David, right? I think David, if you wanted a poster child for it's always right to do right, it's always wrong to do wrong, that would be, in my opinion, as far as a biblical character, that would be David, be one of those people. Because even when he did wrong and he was faced with it, thou art the man, he made amends, right? So David's sort of that poster child for a phrase that somebody around here repeats all the time. So it is, when we see David, we see him showing the kindness of God. What does it mean to show the kindness of God? We see David as an example. We've read some passages about the kindness of God and salvation. But what does it mean to show the kindness of God? I'm sorry? To be merciful? Yes. Yes. WWJD. Not just to, I'm sorry? To care about other people? Yes. Even when it's not deserved. Is that hard sometimes? It is, man, I'm telling you. There are times when there are people who you're just like, I'm going to tell all myself, but I have to think really hard. Jesus died for them too. Jesus died for them too. I kind of find my happy place, because there are people that just kind of get on your nerves, right? And, you know, it happens. I know you're laughing because it happens. So in relationship to showing the kindness of God, would it not be more magnificent to show the kindness of God to somebody who didn't deserve it? Probably, yes.
When you think of anything that happens, you think of Jesus forgiving the people that were torturing him and killing him and asking God to forgive them.
Yes.
Exactly.
I don't know if you heard that. I mean, just thinking about all that God went, or Christ went through in relationship to his crucifixion and all that he suffered. And, you know, nobody's done that to us. You know, we haven't had to suffer to that degree and still forgive people for that. You know, there's that ultimate example of showing the loving kindness, showing the kindness of God. We see that exampled in Christ. And, you know, us trying to show that to people. Here is Mephibosheth, he didn't necessarily have to do this. As far as he knew, there was nobody left. He could have left this uninvestigated and gone on and been, you know, blissfully ignorant of that there was somebody left. But because of the justness of David, because of his heart, he tried to seek out and make sure he needed to fulfill that promise. Yes, sir? Can't do that. I got like two chapters, man. You're going to take all my material here. No, go ahead. Go ahead. Yes. Yes, there is sort of a restoration kind of feel with this, and that's very good as far as looking at what's going on here. We see you know, David asks, he wants to show the kindness of God. And I think you have to understand the kindness of God to be able to show that to somebody else, right? And I think understanding the kindness of God, and, you know, we may not ever grasp the depth of the love of God. I think the first sermon I ever preached, I think was my people's favorite sermon because it lasted 7 minutes, but I was 14 at the time, I think, so. It was on the love of God. And for me, at 14, 7 minutes was an eternity, you know, on the love of God. But, you know, as you grow up and as you mature and you understand who God is and what He's done, could you not speak for more than 7 minutes about the love of God? Of course, you mature and you understand. And that's a lifestyle or a lifetime of trying to learn more about the kindness of God. So you have to know it to be able to show that. And David definitely has known that in his life. And as we look at what he's about to do here, Ziba tells him, there is still a son of Jonathan who is crippled in both his feet. So the king said to him, where is he? And so they go to find him. And they bring Mephibosheth to David and tells about where he was. And in verse 6, Mephibosheth, the son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, came to David and fell on his face and prostrated himself. So visually what's happening here?
He's scared.
Yes. I mean, there could be a lot. I mean, if you get called by the supreme authority of the land to their throne room, and your father used to be the antagonist to this guy, you know, your father or your grandfather rather used to be somebody who tried to kill this guy, there could be apprehension, right? Anybody ever been called to a meeting and you have no idea what the meeting's about and you're thinking, I don't know, did I do something wrong? I don't know. And so here's this is very, it could be life and death situation for him. And he falls on his face prostrate before David. So this shows physically a showing of where he's putting himself in this situation. And he said, here is your servant. And David said to him, do not fear, right? For I will surely show kindness to you for the sake of your father Jonathan, and will restore to you all the land of your grandfather Saul, and you shall eat at my table regularly. Probably not what he expected to hear. Some good news, right? Some good news. Here's a guy who's crippled in both his feet, and we understand that he does have a son, so he's crippled in both his feet. What do you think prospect-wise as far as job opportunities are out there for him? He couldn't work for a tech company, all right, you know, and make phone calls or you know, work at a desk. There weren't those kind of jobs necessarily out there. Walking was a key element in survival in that time. And they didn't have, like, I don't know if you guys have seen the wheelchair that has, like, tank tracks on it. Have y'all seen that at all? They didn't have those kind of cool things to use. No, they didn't have those kind of things. So as far as possibilities for this guy, it wasn't looking good for him. What is his response? What is his response in verse 8? What does he do physically? What does he say?
You have to remember, too, that he left after they heard the death of Jonathan. He left in fear. They were terrified.
Yes.
So his mindset, he gets called by that man who they left in fear for him.
Yeah, I mean, you can imagine the day that he had to leave, 5 years old, probably left an impression on him, not only physically because he couldn't walk anymore after that day, but, you know, just mentally thinking about we have to flee from David. Everybody's telling you have to flee from David. David's going to kill you. You've heard that all your life. And now David's called you up. And so you can imagine how he's maybe made a monster out of David or just really kind of thought this is going to be somebody who, if he had a chance, he'd kill me. Probably. And look at verse 8. What does he do again? So it appears that he stood up, or at least was held up. And then what does he do again in response? Yes, he falls right back down and says, who am I? Who is your servant that you should regard a dead dog like me? What is his vision of self in that moment? Not real high, right? This could be, I mean, there's various ways of interpreting. This could be false humility because he just does not want to make sure he doesn't get killed. This could be a situation where he's lived a life where he's been dealt very little, you know, been given very little, and all of a sudden he's going to be eating at the king's table on a regular basis, or he's trying to show just how small he is. But why a dead dog? Why would he say a dead dog? Of all the things, why not a dead goat or a dead sheep or something? Yes. That's actually very accurate. So a dog, could you have a dog or a cat if you were a Jew? You could not. Now, I understand not having cats, but not having dogs? So Leviticus 11:27 tells us that basically, you know, you can't have any animal that has padded feet. So you're not allowed to have those. Cats, they walk up on the counters, you know. Dogs, I would want a dog, but you couldn't have a dog. You couldn't have a dog if you were a Jew. Now, when was a dog the most unclean? When it's rolled in something, because dogs are famous for doing that, right? When is a dog the most unclean to a Jew? Not like when it rolls in his vomit? How about when it's dead? The dog, the most unclean thing is a dead scavenger animal, which is what a dog is. You could not be more unclean. I mean, unless you were leper or something like that. You could not be more unclean. If you touched a dead dog or even anything dead, you would have to go wash your whole body and all your clothes and anything involved in that process and then be unclean until the evening. So, you know, it wasn't something that you wanted to be around. So what is he doing? Here's David, the chosen of God, the king of Israel, and here's Mephibosheth down here on the bottom saying, I'm like the lowest rung. And so he's really showing the separation there in relationship to that. It's interesting also that 1 Chronicles chapter 9, we talked about, and we'll mention that a little bit. 1 Chronicles is sort of like another version of 1 and 2 Samuel and 1 and 2 Kings. It's like the Cliff Notes version. It's a little cleaned up. A lot more genealogies in it. But it's not, this story is not in 1 Chronicles. 1 Chronicles chapter 18 coincides with 2 Samuel chapter 8. And then we have 1 Chronicles chapter 19 coincides with chapter 10. But this story of Mephibosheth is not in the Chronicles. But what is in the Chronicles is the mentioning of Mephibosheth. They actually use a different name. Remember Mephibosheth and Ishbosheth, right? Those two guys. Their names are Esh Baal and Merib Baal. Do you know what the Baals are? Baal? We remember Baal? We're talking about the false gods, the idols. And so in Samuel, they translated their names to and they put in this kind of ending, Bosheth, which means shame. And so there is said that there's some shame tied to his name. His actual name means dispeller of shame. But could it be because we look at his name, or at least how he refers to himself, that instead of being a dispeller of shame, he kind of took a lot of shame on himself because of background. It's possible that he could have taken a lot of shame on himself. And so, and we look at his response, who am I that you would consider me? We see people respond that way when God, like Saul, when Saul was chosen, he kind of had that same kind of response. But this story continues to get better for Mephibosheth. Verse 9, the king calls Saul's servant Ziba and says to him, all that belonged to Saul and to his house, I have given to your master's grandson, and your sons and your servant shall cultivate the land for him. Now remember that Saul was from what tribe? Do you remember? Benjamin. So you're going to be up in Gibeon in the northern part, and so he'll go back to that area as far as having that land. And so Ziba had 15 sons, which is great. He had 20 servants, so a lot of people to cultivate the land. And Ziba says, I'll do according to what my king has commanded. And so he does that. And so Mephibosheth eats at David's table as one of the king's sons. So here is somebody, he has very much a ransom story. He's ransomed back. You know, Hallmark would be all over this if they knew about this story. And so here is this young man. Mephibosheth had a young son whose name was Micah, and all lived in the house of Ziba and with servants. So Mephibosheth lived in Jerusalem, because you remember Jerusalem is not close to where the property or Saul's property is. But he lived in Jerusalem and ate at the king's table. Now he was lame in both feet, which, did they really have to do that? Did they really have to add that on the end there? But they did, just so you don't forget that he was lame in both feet. Any questions about that? It's a neat story. David, again, being a man who's just, thinks about the promise he made to Jonathan and fulfills that promise. Does he have to? He didn't necessarily have to, but he did it. And we see that there in chapter 9. Now, chapter 10, we get back to the fighting and the fun stuff. None of this Hallmark stuff anymore. Again, this coincides with 1 Chronicles chapter 19. Very, very similar. There's not going to be much of a difference in the two. So, now it happened afterwards that the king of the Ammonites died, and Hanun, his son, became king in his place. Then David said, I will show kindness to Hanun and the son of Nahash, just as his father showed kindness to me. Now, the Ammonites, whenever the people of Israel came in to the promised land, or were getting near the promised land, if you remember sort of the coastline of Israel, and if you follow that coastline down, you would come into Egypt, right? And there was like the King's Highway, and there were roads that normally people, when they would travel into Israel, you would just follow along the coast and go right up into the promised land. That would be the normal way of doing it, the fastest, most expedient. They, you know, had to wander around in the desert. There are some lessons they had to learn before they could go right into the promised land. But they kind of came out, made a wide right, and kind of came back in from on the other side of the Jordan River, and had to kind of come in through the Ammonites. And they even asked, hey, can we pass through? Numbers chapter 21, verses 30 and 31. They asked, hey, can we come through? And the king at the time said, no, you can't come through. And they're saying, we're not even going to use your water. We're not even going to do anything. We're just going to pass through. And the king, Sihon, attacked them. And they said, well, you started it. We're going to finish it. And the people of Israel kind of just took over that area of the Ammonites and dwelt in the cities of the Ammonites for a period. And so history-wise, they've had run-ins with these dudes in the past. Now, David mentions something here that's a little bit different. What does he say? I will show kindness to Hanun, the son of Nahash, just as his father showed kindness to me. Do you know what? We have no idea what he's talking about. We don't know what David's talking about, what kind of kindness was shown to David by this king. There's obviously things that happened in the life of David that we know nothing about, and this is one of those things. Tradition says that he saved his brother when the king of Moab killed his family, or killed some of his family. That's what tradition says. That's just tradition. It's the same tradition that says, there was a city named after Nahash, Nahashville, which later became Nashville. The same kind of tradition. Go ahead. Yeah, there's no telling what exactly. There could have been that situation where they were kind of helping each other out in relationship to Saul. It could have been that he sought refuge with them whenever he was running from Saul. We don't know exactly what happened, but there was a kindness shown. David decides, some of you are reading ahead because I'm rambling. Some of you are reading ahead, and what does he say? What happens? David decides to show kindness, and what does David decide to do? Sorry? Yeah, that's nice, right? Somebody's father died, so he sends people to console him. David sent concerning his father. But when David's servants came to the land of the Ammonites, the princes of the Ammonites, and you, this happened to Rehoboam as well. These young princes think they know everything. The princes of the Ammonites said to Hanun their lord, "Do you think that David is honoring your father because he has sent consolers to you? Has David not sent his servants to you in order to search the city, to spy it out and overthrow it?" So Hanun took David's servants and shaved off half their beards and cut off their garments in the middle as far as their hips and sent them away. So what? David, out of the kindness of his heart, sends people to console this man who lost his father, and they are met with a razor and scissors, right? And that's how they're received. Now, is it a big deal to get your beard cut off? I mean, some people grow them and shave them off all the time. It's not that big a deal. But if you're a Jew, is it a big deal if your beard gets cut? Yes, it is. There were actually laws about Leviticus chapter 19, verse 27, talks about how they are even to groom their beards. There was a grooming policy in relationship to beard etiquette with the Jews. And not only that, this was sort of a sign of defeat. It wasn't like you do this too with your best friends, ha ha ha, I shaved off half your beard when you were sleeping. No, this is a sign of defeat to them. This is something that they've done to really not just these men, but to insult David as well. So they did not just insult these guys and just some, you know, locker room pranks. This was meant to insult David, and they succeeded in doing that. Now, what is told, what happened, and when they told of it to David, he sent to meet them, and the men were greatly humiliated, obviously. And the king said, "Stay at Jericho until your beards grow, and then return." So they were able to kind of maybe stay at a city that nobody knows them and grow their beard back until they go back to their families or something. So anyway, so what is the result of said insult? Verse 6, what is the result? Yeah, they prepared for war. We go to war. So they prepared, they made insults of David, right? And now when the sons of Ammon saw that they had become odious to David, the sons of Ammon sent and hired Arameans. And it talks about the people they hired, soldiers, and the different various peoples. Now these guys, so Ammon is here, just kind of, basically just straight, I think that's east, just straight east of Jerusalem is Ammon. And then on the other side, the Arameans, another group of people, and they hire them to go into battle against them. And so in verse 9, Joab, who is the commander of David's army, saw that the battle was set against him in front and in the rear. So they go out. In verse 8, the sons of Ammon came out and drew up in battle array. I like that, just battle array. That means they lined up and got ready to fight. So this is going to be epic. At the entrance of the city, while the Arameans of Zobah and Rehob, the men of Tob, and this other guy, were by themselves in the field. So you have two forces. Now, let's just think about this. If you're going into battle, you want to do like this, right? You want to just fight head to head. You don't want a divided battle front, do you? Is that fun? Is it fun to go into battle and you've got somebody in front of you you've got to be dealing with and somebody behind you that's taking pock shots at you? No, that's not fun. And so that's what's happening in this situation. And so when Joab realizes what's going on, he says that we're getting attacked in these different ways. So he calls the selected or the choice men of Israel and arrayed them against the Arameans, but the remainder of the people he placed at the hand of Abishai, his brother, and arrayed them against the sons of Ammon. Now this is interesting, kind of comes into play. In chapter 8, verse 13, it says, David made a name for himself when he returned from killing 18,000 Arameans in the Valley of Salt. When you look over in 1 Chronicles chapter 18, and you read that same verse, it says Abishai was the one who defeated them. So is there a discrepancy in the Bible here? They were together. And as more than likely Abishai was the commander of the army at that time, everything goes to the credit of David. If David's army goes out, it's David who gets the credit for the victory. His commanders, you know, get some credit, but it is Abishai who was the commander, more than likely, in the Valley of Salt, which is south of the Dead Sea. And so he has experience in relationship to doing this. And so there's these two battle brothers who are facing this onslaught. And so they are beginning to fight this battle. And he said, "If the Arameans are too strong for me, then you shall help me. And if the Ammonites are too strong for you, then I will come and help you." But this verse 12, I'm going to focus on this for a moment. "Be strong and let us show ourselves courageous for the sake of our people and for the cities of our God. And may the Lord do what is good in his sight." Does that sound familiar? Like I may have heard that somewhere. Be strong and courageous. Look over in Deuteronomy chapter 31, verse 6. Deuteronomy chapter 31. You remember Deuteronomy, this book is basically Moses preaching to the people before they go into the promised land. And he's basically telling them in a nutshell, don't do what you did before and bail out, okay? Make sure you complete the will of God and do what you're supposed to do. But in chapter 31, in verse 6, this is sort of mentioned again. It says, "Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or tremble at them concerning the people of the land of Canaan. For the Lord your God is the one who goes with you, and he will not fail or forsake you." So this is this battle cry that begins to be formed. And then Joshua, in Joshua chapter 1, it's mentioned three times. Mentioned three times in Joshua chapter 1 about be strong and courageous, do not be afraid, God goes with you, he's faithful. It's mentioned in relationship to battle. It's mentioned in relationship to fulfilling the will of God, be strong and courageous and fulfill the word that God has given you. And then it is mentioned in relationship to people who are deserters and making sure that when people do not obey and you have to destroy them, that to be strong and courageous in those things. Do we not have to be strong and courageous sometimes in doing the will of God? Is it always cake? Is it always easy to do the will of God? No, it's not. And we have to be strong and courageous to do what God has said. If it's fighting, if it's following His will, if it's defending the faith, if it's standing where nobody else is standing, if it's standing alone, be strong and courageous. God is faithful. It was true for men who were holding swords. It's true for you when you're holding your Bible. And it's true for you when you're standing around on truth. Do not back down. And so here's a battle cry, this old battle cry that they cried out before they went into Canaan. He's crying it out now to his brother, do not lose heart, and we will win if we win, but God is going to be with us. God is going to be with us. And so here's this battle cry. So Joab and the people who, and I love how this happened, the way the text reads, they just walk up to the line and everybody goes, we're running away. And there's no real like fight, mentioned in the text. So Joab and the people who were with him drew near to the battle against the Arameans, and they fled before him. Does it say they did anything? The text does not tell us they did anything. The text tells us they marched up to the battle line, and everybody else just fled. Now we see in some other battles that God had in some ways sowed fear into the enemy. In various ways. And it may be the case here that God had sown fear into these enemies and they just fled. And so they chased them. And the sons of Ammon saw that the Arameans fled. They also fled because that was a popular thing to do, apparently. And so they fled before Abishai and entered in the city. Run away. So they ran away. And Joab returned from fighting against the sons of Ammon and came to Jerusalem. Now when the Arameans saw... All right. So we have to do this again. Now when the Arameans saw they'd been defeated by Israel, they gathered themselves together. Well, we can't let this happen. Does that happen with people? You know, it happens. It happens here. They couldn't let this go unanswered. And so Hadazer sent and brought out the Arameans. Now, chapter 8 mentions that they defeated this guy once already. Chapter 8 mentions they defeated him. It does not mention that they killed him, but it mentions that they had defeated him before. So he's already lost to Israel in the past. So he doesn't have a great history in relationship to fighting against Israel. And so here he comes up again, and the Arameans who are beyond. So they gather up the Arameans, and they gather up Arameans who are beyond the river. Do you guys have another word there other than river? We're talking about the Euphrates. So we're talking about gathering up a lot of people to come fight. We're calling in all the clans, and we're going to go fight. And the king Dehelam and Sobach, the commander of the army, Abiezer, led them. And now it was told to David that this was happening. He gathered all Israel. That's what you got to do if you're getting attacked. And so they gathered them all together, and they met and fought against him. Verse 18, the Arameans fled before Israel, and David killed 700 charioteers of the Arameans, 40,000 horsemen, and struck down Sobach and the commander of the army. So it laid great waste to this army that came against them. And then all the king's servants of Hadadezer saw they were defeated by Israel. They made peace with Israel. That should have been what they did earlier, right? They probably should have led with that. So here they are, utterly defeated. At least in their minds at this moment, there's no way that they're going to fight against Israel again. And so what do? Let's be friends, right? I don't want to be on the receiving end of this again. Let's be friends. They made peace. They made peace with Israel and serve them. So what it means to make peace is that, okay, we will be a vassal kingdom to you. We will have to pay you some sort of taxation to you. And so David received that taxation from the Arameans. So the Arameans feared to help the sons of Ammon anymore. What does that mean? The next time you call, guys, we are not answering that call to go against David or to go against Israel. We're not doing that. And so that ends chapter 10 and some of the conquests of David. And we will start next Wednesday and talk about a rather infamous life or a section of the life of David. Any questions or thoughts or anything before we finish tonight? All right. Thank you very much for your time.